So I hope you're all ready to receive what Spirit of God has to say today. Last week, we looked at baggage. Anyone remember that? You know, we looked at the kind of things that we carry along all through our lifetime. Okay? We talked about three kinds of baggage carriers. One person who is a drunk person, who has accumulated so much of stuff, you don't know what to do with it, you shut that down. Then we saw a suitcase person. Then we went on to see a backpack person. So if you're wondering what are all this, you need to go back to the sermon and watch it. So I'm not going to explain that today. All right? But if any time you have traveled, especially in a flight, okay, we realize that what you take in your baggage determines whether you will fly or not. Right? What's in your bag can keep you from flying. Am I right? Yeah? So the airlines gives out instructions, right? Tells us what things can we carry, what things we cannot carry. Okay? Now these are some of the items that the airline says we should not be carrying in our bag. Right? List of prohibited acids, poisons, flammable, explosives, bleach. These are some of the things that you cannot carry, right? If at all you want to carry, if at all you have packed them in your baggage, you know what's going to happen, right? Your baggage is going to be screened. And once they discover the items, either you have to take those items out or you have to forego your flight. If you're not willing to take your items out, the airline will say, we're not going to take you on our flight. That's what they would say, right? And it's the same thing in our lives too sometimes. We put items, okay, harmful items in our baggage, okay? And we want to fly. We want to go high because God's desire is each one of us will fly higher. God's desire is that we will move on in His things, move on to fulfill, accomplish everything that He has for us. But so many of us packed in some dangerous items in our bags. And every time you want to fly, it's pulling you down. Every time you want to get off, move forward in the things of God, it pulls you back. Because the baggage is so heavy, containing all items that are not helping you in your walk. Now you look at them, it says poison, gases, bleach. You can't carry all of them. But somehow in our life, in the spiritual life, in our spiritual bag, suitcase, we have packed these items. We have packed these items. And time again, they come out. They come out in our lives. Whenever you want to take the next step, and they pull you back. And today, I really want to help us to understand how we can lighten our baggage, how we can overcome things, how we can deal with things that are prohibited in our bags and move forward in the things of God. You know, as I said, Valentine's Day is coming. Some of you probably are looking for, you're single and you're looking for Mr. or Mrs. Right. And the Mr. or Mrs. Right will never come into your life unless you deal with some baggage. Because if they come now, they'll be surprised at the baggage that you're carrying along. And especially in a marriage relationship too, probably jump from one relationship to another. Maybe you were married now and you got a divorce and you want to get into another marriage. But if you don't deal with baggage, you'll carry the same baggage from one relationship to another relationship. And your life will still be the same. It's not going to change because you're carrying the same baggage. You haven't let go of some things in your life. Unless you let go, you'll never be able to go forward in the things of God. You want to be happy, but you can't seem to even get past. You can't even get on the plane of happiness because your baggage of your past, baggage of your rejection, baggage of stuff that you've been carrying it all along is pulling you down. Every time a door of opportunity comes, every time something opens up, you want to step in, but you see this baggage hanging along with you, taking along with you. In a business, take in any situation, in a business, you know, you've been cheated probably, you've been, and you don't want to take the next one that comes your way. Because you've been carrying baggage, you didn't know how to deal with it. All right? So one of the things we saw last week is a very dangerous item called offense. Everybody shout offense. Offense. Right? We all carry offenses, by the way. There is no one who is not carrying an offense. And in fact, the scripture talks about it. You know, Jesus says, okay? Jesus says in Luke chapter 17, verse 1, he says, offenses are inevitable. Luke 17, verse 1 says, it is impossible that no offenses should come. Okay? It is impossible that no offenses should come. In other words, he's saying, in your life, you will always face offense. You cannot live free of offense. It's going to come, whether you are, as I said, 15, 25, 50, 70, whatever. Offenses are going to be part of your life. All right? So they are inevitable. That's what Jesus said. Second thing we saw was offenses are a trap. The word in the Greek is a word called scandalon, which means the trigger of a trap on which the bait is placed. And I explain, right? If you want to catch a rat, you set up a trap, you find the straps, right? If the old-fashioned traps, okay? You put a bait, right? And you leave it there, and sooner or later, the rat would come and take a bite of that bait, whether it be a cheese or coconut, something that you leave it for it to bite on. But you know what happens, right? The moment it bites it, the trap door will lock into place. And offenses are like that. Some of us are trapped in our offenses today. You know, I can understand some of you have been treated unjustly, unfairly, and you're offended about that. Yes, it can happen in our lives, okay? Some of you have perceived that you are offended, but some of us are also people who pick up other people's offenses, right? It's not your offense, but what's your friend was hurt, and the friend comes to you and tells you, and then you get angry, right? You know, and then you get angry, and instead, that's not even your offense. You pick on that offense, and you know what happens? You took a bite. You take a bite of it, and you are trapped into that now. So offenses are a trap. Number three, offense opens the door to deception. Deception, right? It's not going to help you. It's going to ruin you. You know, that's what Matthew says. Matthew 24, verse 1 says, in the last days, he's talking about the last days, that many will be offended. They will betray one another and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up, okay, and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. The very reason, the very thing that you and I should be talking about is love. The Bible says, they shall know them. They shall know us by our love. And when you entertain offense, when you get trapped into offense, your love is going to get grow cold. Leads you into downfall. The trap of offense opens the door to deception. Number four, offenses are most inflicted by those who we are closest to. Right, as I said last week, if you're there, marriage is a hotbed for offense. You know all about it. People close to you can offend you the most. Right? That's part of our life. And finally, we look at this. Offenses are inevitable, but carrying them is a choice. Carrying them is your choice. Jesus said, offenses will come your way. But whether you will take a bite of it, and get into a trap, or if you want to be free, it's your choice. So today, I really want to help us understand how we can escape the trap of offense. How we can work things out in our lives to be free from the trap of offense. Here we go. Number one, okay? The quicker we let go of offense, Okay, and I said, the quicker we let go of offense, the more free we are going to be. Anybody stained their clothes at any point of time in your life? Come on, show me your hand if you stained your clothes. How do you treat that? They say, your best chance of treating a stain on your clothes is the moment it happens. The moment it happens, you take a corrective measure, right? And that's when you have a better chance of the stain going off your clothes. But you don't act on it immediately, and you let it soak for a while. Your chances of removing that stain off your clothes becomes very narrow, very less. The same way with offense, okay? The quicker you act on it, the more free you're gonna be. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 11, says like this, says, a person's wisdom yields patience. And observe this, it is to one's glory to overlook an offense. Wow. The ESV, another translation, says like this, good sense makes one slow to anger, and it is his glory to overlook an offense. How do you deal with that? You choose to overlook. The moment it comes, that's when you decide. What are you going to do with that offense? Whether you're going to cause that offense to take deep root in your life and trap you, or are you going to say, okay, I'm going to let it go. Right? It says, it is his glory. It is your glory to overlook an offense. It is for our good. Carrying it is not good. If we learn to overcome, if we learn to overlook offenses, I'm telling you, you will live a more satisfied and a happy life. You know, I spoke, Jesus was no stranger to offense. Right, there were many opportunities for him to be offended. He could have been offended by the way he was treated by his own family, by his own brothers. He could have been offended by the religious leaders and scribes who were always questioning him. You were always despising him. He could have been offended by his disciples who sometimes didn't believe in what he was doing. He could have been offended by Judas Iscariot who betrayed him. He had ample opportunities to be offended. But the Bible says, you know, he would never allow those things to dominate in his life. He would never allow other people's opinions to dominate him. He would be free of that. He would be free of that. And we got to have that kind of attitude in our lives. Like Jesus, okay? We can let go of offenses. You know, Paul also learned to deal with offense. In 2 Timothy, he writes to Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14, he says, Alexander, the metal worker, did me a great deal of harm. And he says, look at what he says, the Lord will repay him for what he has done. Oftentimes, we can come into the trap of attacking the offender. But look at what Paul learned to say. He did me a great deal of harm. I just give it him to God. I'm not going to take it upon me. Let the Lord deal with him. You got to learn to deal like Paul. You have to have that same kind of attitude. We need to turn the situation around like Paul did and turn it over to God. So offenses will show up. It's just how you are going to handle that offense when it shows up will make a difference in your life. Now, so many of us are foodies over here, right? I'm a foodie, by the way. I love to eat. Anyone here want to try new foods? Right? Now, so in our quest of trying new foods, you know, you come across some food, you take a bite into your mouth, and you know the horrible feeling that you have in your mouth. Right? But when you have that horrible feeling in your mouth, what do you do? you spit it out. You don't care who is around you. Because it's not a good taste in your mouth. It tastes horrible. And so this is not my kind of food. You spit it out. That's how you have to deal with an offense. Offense is bitter. Offense doesn't taste good in your life. So the moment you have it in your mouth, you need to learn to spit it out, not swallow it. Because when you swallow it, then you'll be in a trap. That's what happens. So come on, let's be people who will act on it the moment it comes into our lives. We got to take a moment and think twice about taking up offense. Is it going to benefit you? Is it going to make your life any better? Is it going to make you more happy, more joyful? Or is it going to take you down the drain? It's your choice. It's your choice. Nobody's going to force it on you. It's your choice. So the faster you act on it, your life will be better. Second thing, some of us have carried so many things along. So let's take inventory of current offenses and determine that you will deal with them. Now, we all carried offenses, okay? Someone said something about you. Someone said something about you, about your family, about how you acted, how you behaved, how you dress up. Today we live in a world, people can get offended for a tiny thing. That's how it is, right? If somebody doesn't appreciate you, you are offended. Appreciates you, then also you're offended. Why is he appreciating me like this? Let's take inventory of current offenses and determine that you'll deal with them. Putting them back in your baggage is not going to help. You got to learn to deal with them. You know what? Every offense not properly handled will give room for the enemy to come in. Think about that. It will open a door for the devil. Every offense that you don't handle it, don't deal with it, you will open yourself up for the enemy. There's a story in the Bible, okay? King Saul, okay, and David. David defeated Goliath, right? We all know the story. And because of that victory, people began to praise David for the efforts. And then they began to sing about him. You'll find that in 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 6. It says like this. It says, when the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the woman came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing, with joyful songs and with timbrels and lyres. As they danced, they sang, Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands. Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. They have credited David with tens of thousands, he thought, but with me only thousands. What more can he get out? What more can he get but the kingdom? And from that time on, Saul kept a close eye on David. Now you see the situation, right? Everyone was praising David. Saul got offended. How can they talk about David when I am the king here? They're talking about David killing tens of thousands and they only talk about me as killing thousands. He took the bite of offense. He took the bite of offense and see what happens in his life. Verse 10 says, the next day, an evil spirit from God came forcefully on Saul. He was prophesying in his house while David was playing the lyre as he usually did. Saul had a spear in his hand and he hurled it, saying to himself, I'll pin David to the wall. Don't we do that sometimes in our lives? Right? When you get offended, you want to throw that spear. That's exactly what it says. He's opened the door for the enemy. He opened the door for the enemy to come into his life. So much so he begins to despise David. Verse 29, it says, Saul became still more afraid of him and he remained his enemy the rest of his days. He didn't take stock. He take inventory of the offense. And he harbored it. He carried it. He carried it until he saw David as his enemy for the rest of his life. If you don't take inventory, my friends, you're going to open the door for the devil. So act on it. Don't delay it. The next thing I want to say is that guard your freedom by recognizing the traps. Guard your freedom by recognizing the traps. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, it says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. In other words, it says, the baggage that you carry will bring out issues in your life. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Some of us are carrying baggage, and it is determining the way we are walking, the way we are acting in our lives. And it says, guard your heart. Recognize when offense comes in. Don't take the bite. When the enemy lays out that bait, don't bite on it. You will be trapped. So don't be offended. Guard your heart. You know, Abraham learned how to guard his heart when an offense came his way. In Genesis chapter 13, verse 7 says, and quarreling arose between Abram's herders and Lot's. The Canaanites and Perizzites were also living in the land at the time. So Abram said to Lot, let's not have any quarreling between you and me, or between your herders and mine, for we are close relatives. Is not the whole land before you? Let's part company. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. If you go to the right, I'll go to the left. Now Abraham, you know, they were having conflict between his herdsmen and Lot's herdsmen. And Abraham sees this. So he could have been offended because he was the one who was taking care of Lot. He said, man, I'm trying to help this guy out and his people are fighting against my people. He could have been offended. But look at, when there was an opportunity for him to offend, look what he did. He said, okay, I'm going to deal this in a better way. He says, let's not have any quarreling between you and me, okay? This is not going to help us. So you choose the land that you want to stay. And if you choose one particular side of the land, he says, I will go to the other side of the land. What's Abraham doing here? He's guarding his heart from falling into a trap that the enemy has set. He could have been offended. They could have fought between themselves. It could have happened. Okay, there could have been a major fight between Abraham and Lot. And that's what happens in our families, right? We are not strangers to this. Oh, it happens in our families. How many of us don't fight between cousins and us? Come on. But Abraham chose to guard his heart. And said, I'm not going to let this dictate our relationship. He says, okay, the best way to deal with this and be good on good terms, he said, okay, you go your way, I'll go my way. And Abraham doesn't stop there. He goes one step ahead. At one point of time, when Lot was living in an area, he was captured by the people around them. Genesis chapter 14, okay? And they'd capture Lot and take him away. Verse 12 says, they also carried off Abraham's nephew Lot and his possessions since he was living in Sodom. A man who had escaped came and reported this to Abraham the Hebrew. Now Abraham was living near the great trees of Mamre, the Amorite, a brother of Eshcol and Aner, and all of whom were allied with Abraham. When Abraham heard that his relative had been taken captive, he called out the 318 trained men born in his household and went in pursuit as far as Dan. During the night, Abraham divided his men to attack them and he routed them, pursuing them as far as Hobah, north of Damascus. He recovered all the goods and brought back his relative Lot and his possessions together with the woman and the other people. Now look at what is Abraham doing. He chose to guard his freedom. Chose to guard his heart from being offended, but he doesn't stop there. Okay, we dealt with this. Now you go your way, I go my way. Okay, but he goes a step further and says, okay, when he hears that his nephew Lot was captured, he doesn't stay still anymore. He said, oh, I need to do something about it. He goes and rescues Lot. And that's the kind of attitude we should be having. Not only guarding our hearts, but if something happens to the person who has offended you, you better go there and help them out. Guard your peace. Guard your peace. Fourth one, position yourself to be the restorer. Now I want you to know this. Your ability to properly handle offenses is a test of spiritual maturity. Come on. It's a test of spiritual maturity. You know, some of us, we all take pride, okay, I was born again, I filled with the Holy Spirit, baptized, speak in tongues, I speak the word of God, I do miracles, but someone asks you to do something that is not, you don't like it, you get offended. Someone will take you out of the team. Come on, I'm talking something here today. Say, no, I don't want you to be on the team. You get offended. Someone takes you out of the WhatsApp group. Come on. Nothing else will offend you as much as your name being removed from a WhatsApp group. Am I right? Come on. Let's deal with it. Position yourself to be that restorer. Okay? God has given us this message of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians 5:18 says, and all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. It says, God did not count sins against us. And he says, he gave us this message of reconciliation. You got to be the person who will be the one who will start the reconciliation process. If you're offended, you start the reconciliation process. You know, Matthew chapter 6. If as a believer you find it difficult to let go of offenses, then you are not mature enough. You are not mature. You need to grow in God. You need to grow in God. This will determine whether you are spiritually mature or not. Your behavior, your act will determine. If someone comes and takes your seat, come on, sometimes people act up. This is my seat. Maturity. Maturity is a test of your maturity. Matthew 6:14 says, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. You know, your forgiveness is a condition. It says, if you don't forgive, then your heavenly Father says, will not forgive you. If you learn to forgive, he says, then your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Paul learns about this, okay? 2 Corinthians 2, verse 10 says, anyone you forgive, I also forgive. And what I have forgiven, if there was anything to forgive, I have forgiven in the sight of Christ for your sake. Now listen to this. In order that Satan might not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. Paul says, I learn to forgive when someone offends me because I don't want to give space to the enemy. I don't want to give an inch of space for the enemy to come into life. Because if I carry offense, I open the door for him, by the way. And Paul says, no, I'll choose to forgive. I will be the one who will be the restorer of relationship. 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 9 says, do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. Come on. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing. We got to be different, right? Because to this you were called so. You are called to this so that you may inherit a blessing. Inherit a blessing. Come on, let's be the people who will be the restorer, right? And start practicing forgiveness. Practicing forgiveness. That's what. Practice forgiveness. make a decision not to hold on to offenses by settling and forgiving easily. If you're not willing to let go of offenses, you're not yet ready to walk in full maturity that God has designed for you. The Bible is clear in how you deal with an offense. Someone has hurt you. Matthew chapter 18 gives us four steps. Matthew 18:15 says, if another believer sins against you, first thing you got to do, what does it say? Go. Come on, read it with me. Go privately and point out the offense. What do we do? We go public. That's what we do. We go public with the offense. But the Bible says go private. And that's what we do, right? You are offended by something. You are offended by the leadership. You are offended by someone. You put it on your social media. You put it on your Insta handle. And you know what happens? 100 people get into that trap. That was not even theirs. They took the bite. Bible says deal with this way. Don't go public. Go personally, privately, and point out the offense. That's what you have to do, my friends. Not go public, but go private. And goes on to say, if the other person listens and confesses it, you have won that person back. Okay? But if you are unsuccessful, take one or two others with you and go back again, so that everything you say may be confirmed by two or three witnesses. If they don't listen, if you go privately, spoke to them, they don't listen to it, take a couple of people with you. Again, sort that out. Okay? And then it goes on to say, still that, verse 17, if the person still refuses to listen, take your case to the church. Then if he or she won't accept the church's decision, treat that person as a pagan and a corrupt tax collector. Wow. We have been dealing this the whole wrong way till now. Right? Whole wrong way. We thought we were believers. We thought we were tongue speakers. When the Bible says go privately, we went all over public. Come on, it's time to change. It's time to learn. Practice forgiveness. Practice forgiveness. Now, that does not mean the other person might forgive you or they might totally deny it. But that's not in your hands. The thing that is in your hands is you start the process. You be the reconciler. You be the one who'll say, okay, I felt offended by what you said. Can I understand why you said that? Okay, you go to that person and deal with it. If they offers forgiveness, you won. If it doesn't, okay, let it go. That's not you. That's not on you. But you have started the process. So come on, let's be people who will practice forgiveness. Romans 12:17 says, never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you are honorable. Do all that you can live in peace with everyone. Peace with them. Practice forgiveness. If you don't practice forgiveness, you know what? Something happens. The blessing of God is stopped. Come on, I want the worship team, okay? It says, offenses close the heavens upon the offended when not properly handled. Some of you are thinking, why my blessing is not there? Maybe it's a reason that you have to look into. Offenses close the heavens upon us, okay? Matthew 5:23 says, so if you are presenting a sacrifice at the altar in the temple and you suddenly remember that someone has something against you, leave your sacrifice there at the altar. Go and be reconciled to that person first. Then come and offer your sacrifice to God. It's not saying, don't lift up your hands and worship God. If you know someone's, you have a grudge against someone, first deal with that. Practice forgiveness. And you know what? I'll take you to a story. The story of Job is a very interesting story. Now, Job lost everything, okay? Lost everything, his family, his possessions, his cattle, everything he lost. And he was sitting down in burlap, ashes, and his friends come. And they began to reason with him why he was in that mess. And they gave him different reasons. Okay, your sin might have done this. You must have disobeyed God, which was not true in any way. But the Bible actually says Job got offended by what these people are saying. At one point of time says, what foolish people you are. What kind of comforters you are. He tells them. And if it goes on, at the end of the story, something happens. In Job 42, after all the discussions, God hears all the discussions and God begins to speak up in that situation. And he tells Job, tells all of the people how they were wrong. And this is what he says after that. Verse 7 says, Job 42:7. After the Lord had finished speaking to Job, he said to Eliphaz the Temanite, I am angry with you and your two friends, for you have not spoken accurately about me as my servant Job has. So take 7 bulls and 7 rams and go to my servant Job and offer a burnt offering for yourselves. My servant Job will pray for you and I will accept his prayer on your behalf. I will not treat you as you deserve, for you have not spoken accurately about me as my servant Job has. So the Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite did as the Lord commanded them, and the Lord accepted Job's prayer. Now here's what's happening over here. So God listens to all of them, and God tells him, hey, you guys are not speaking up properly, so I want you to do something. I want you to take a sacrifice. 3 of his friends said, take a sacrifice, go to Job. And he tells Job another thing. He says, what does this tell? God tells Job, says, Job will pray for you. Now this guy is offended, by the way, of all of his friends. But God tells Job also, hey, I know you're offended, but I want you to pray for them. I want you to forgive them. And, you know, they haven't spoken accurately about me. You also didn't speak accurately about me. But Job, I want you to pray about them. Can we pray about people who have offended us? And you know what happens after that? Verse 10, it says, when Job prayed for his friends, see what happens. When Job prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his, that means his blessings came through. Right? Everything that he held up came through. In fact, the Lord gave him twice as much before. Offenses can stop you from experiencing the blessings of God. It's time to deal with it. Don't carry it. It's not going to help you. It's not taking your life higher. You're not going to fly if you carry offense. You're going to go down. It's time to get rid of them. Deal with them. Let them go. Forgive people. How do we do that? When you are constantly filling yourself with the Word of God. Always fill your mind with the Word of God. Psalm 119. Verse 165 says, great peace have they who love your law. That means the Word of God. Now look at this. When you love the law, nothing shall offend them. Nothing shall offend them. When you are full of the Word of God, you will be unoffended. Somebody shout out, unoffended. Unoffended. You make a choice to live unoffended. Great peace. Some of you don't have peace because you're harboring it. You're harboring it. That's why you don't have peace. And Jesus says, Bible says, let it go. Why do you want to suffer? Have some peace. Let go. Overlook. Reconcile. Forgive. And be free. Be happy. Enjoy my blessings. Jesus says that to us today. You've been stuck up. You've been in the trap. God says, I want to set you free today. I want to set you free today. And I want to close with this. If you are the offender, you know, maybe we have offended. I have offended so many people in my life. Right? I had to deal with that sometimes in my life. And if you are the offender, you know, the Bible talks about that person too. It says something like this. It says, Luke 17 verse 1 says, Woe to him through whom they come. That means let's not be offenders. Let's not only be people who will be offended, but let's also be people not offenders. Okay, it says, if you're an offender, if someone comes and requests forgiveness, if you don't give, you're an offender. And the Bible says, all right, if you're an offender, it says, woe to you. Woe to you. Strong words of Jesus, woe to you. He's talking about Christians, believers, not treating others properly, the way they should be dealing with it. You know, Paul talks about it, learns how to deal with all that, how he chose not to be a person who's an offender. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 3 says, we live in such a way, come on, set up the microphones. We live in such a way that no one will stumble because of us. In another translation, the Living Bible, it says, we try to live in such a way, okay, we try to live in such a way that no one will ever be offended or kept back from finding the Lord by the way we act. Come on. By the way we act, so that no one can find fault with us and blame it on the Lord. Today, God wants you to be free from offense. But you know, He's not going to force it on you. You have to deal with that, by the way. He dealt it on the cross for you, so you don't have to be nailed to the cross anymore. But all He wants you to do, deal with it. Just like He has forgiven you, He wants you to forgive. Reconcile. Come on, Lord Christian, eyes closed. Let the Spirit of God speak to you today. Come on. God's leading you, giving you that person, that situation where you are offended, and He wants you to give it off today. He wants you to forgive. Let go. Let go. At the cross, come to Him. Let it go. Let it go. And if this message has spoken to you and you feel, I got to deal with this, I can't carry it anymore, I want to pray along with you today. It's not an easy thing to deal with that. It's hard. But we'll ask the Spirit of God to help us to do that. So if you are that person, you're struggling to deal with it, I want you to stand up wherever you are. It'll be very bold, by the way, to do that, because everybody's watching you. But the moment you stand up, I'll tell you, the chains are going to break, because you started that process. Chains are going to break. Because you started that process. It takes courage to deal with offense. It's not easy. It's not easy. But you say, God, I'm not going to carry it anymore. I'm not going to carry it anymore. I'm not going to carry it anymore. I want to be free. Free of offense. Unoffended. That's what my life should be. Unoffended. Come on. At the cross, lift your hands and say, God, I lay it at the cross. Help me forgive. Help me forgive. Help me deal with it. Lift it up. God, we owe it all to you for our forgiveness. We want to live like you, Jesus, unoffended. So many times we fell into that trap, oh God. But today we choose to deal with those things. We choose to let that go. We choose to forgive people, oh God. We choose to overlook offense, oh God. Come on. Just start to forgive people if you have to forgive people. Just start to overlook offenses if you have to overlook offense today. Today is going to be a day of your freedom. For from this moment on, you will walk in freedom. Freedom. Because God wants to deal with that. In your life, no more baggage. No more offense. No more unforgiveness. I'm going to be mature in Christ. I'll deal with it. God, I pray for grace for everybody who's standing up right now, God, who says, I want to deal with it. I'm not going to carry it anymore. I pray for your grace. I pray for your mercy upon their lives, that they will be able to overlook. They'll be able to forgive. They will be able to reconcile. They'll be able to restore. Restore, oh God. We thank you, Lord God. And I pray that we'll always choose not to be offended. When it comes our way, we'll know exactly how to deal with that. So give us grace, Holy Spirit, to live an unoffended life, oh God. We thank you, God, for that. I pray that your word will continue to take deep root, Lord. Start to investigate into our lives. Root out everything that is not out of you, oh God. So that we can move on in the things that you have for us. We thank you, we adore you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.